Good evening, everyone. Thanks for the introduction. And I thank the organizing secretary, Dr. Thirumurugan, for offering me this topic. So newborn follow-up in office practice is an important one. And in a busy pediatric OPD, where the pediatrician, if he caters to the follow-up of newborns also, then there are certain issues which we have to, you know, pay attention closely. So that some of the common conditions, which are very important in terms of, you know, diagnosis and treatment, are not missed. So in this lecture, next 20 minutes, I will discuss about timing of follow-up in term and preterm newborns. Especially in preterm, I would restrict my discussion to late preterm babies who are between 34 and 37 weeks. And moderate preterm between 32 and 34 weeks, weighing between 1.5 to 1.8 kilos, because less than 1.5 kilo would come under you know, high risk follow up, and that is not the scope of discussion over here. And let us look at common scenarios which we encounter during follow up of these babies, and let us go it in a problem oriented approach way. So how we should time the follow up? So ideally, in a term or a late preterm baby, the discharge usually happens by around 48 to 72 hours, irrespective of the mode of delivery. And ideally, these babies should be followed up in 3 to 5 days. And there are scientific reasons for that. One is that these babies tend to lose maximum weight loss occurs by around 3 to 5 days, and then they should start gaining by the towards the end of the first week, if not later than first week. Then jaundice, the incidence of jaundice peaks at around 5 to 7 days. So when you time the follow-up at this time, then it would be ideal to pick up these two issues. So moderate preterm babies would have spent quite a lot of time in NICU. So you have to, usually you advise them follow up after discharge after a week. Okay, but the issues which we see in preterm, that is moderate preterm and below, are totally different from what you see in this common group, term and late preterm of preterm group of babies. So before going into the scenarios, let us look at the bilirubin nomogram, because you will understand the basis for timing the follow-up based on this. So it has become more or less a common practice to do pre-discharge bilirubin in babies who are at high risk for jaundice. So based on this pre-discharge bilirubin, you can time the follow-up of the babies. So in all babies above 35 weeks of gestation, you can, if your unit protocol is to follow pre-discharge, do pre-discharge bilirubin, then you can decide your follow-up based on that. If the bilirubin falls in the high-risk zone, then the you should not discharge the baby. You may have to repeat bilirubin sooner than in 4 to 8 hours. If it is in the high to intermediate risk zone, then bilirubin has to be repeated in 12 hours. If it is in the low intermediate risk zone, then a bilirubin has to be repeated only after 48 hours. If it is the low-risk zone, 3 to 5 days. So any baby's bilirubin which is done at 48 to 72 hours prior to discharge, if it is falling in the low risk zone, you can follow up the baby after 3 to 5 days. Those are in the low intermediate risk zone, you will follow up in 48 hours. High intermediate and high risk zone, better not to discharge the baby. You may have to track the bilirubin when the baby is in the hospital. Okay. So then let us look at the common scenarios which we commonly encounter when these babies attend our follow-up OPD. So one, the first and foremost thing is poor feeding. How much our baby feeds well, mother may not be happy with the feeding which baby is getting. So she may have a list of complaints that the baby is still not adequately feeding. Weight loss in a baby or inadequate weight gain in the baby is a concern. Jaundice is a concern. There could be superficial infections which you need to address to, and the questions on supplementation to be given to a baby. And of course, of late, newborn screening has become almost universal, and questions pertaining to that also should be addressed to. So let us begin with a scenario. So we have a term baby, 38 weeks, born at gestation of 38 weeks with a birth weight of 3.2 kilos. Baby was discharged from the hospital on day 3 of life on exclusive breastfeeding. presents to OPD with fever, irritability on day 7. So what are all the clinical possibilities when you look at this baby? In OPD practice, obviously, you will think you would want to rule out sepsis. In our country, the incidence of sepsis is high, so it is always high on the card. But we should not forget about the other conditions also, which could result in this kind of presentation. So it could be dehydration. So there may not be dehydration, but really insufficient feeding. Weight loss may be still within the normal range, but still baby is not getting adequate feed. So baby is crying. And there can be other whole list of causes which are very rare, which we will not discuss in this lecture. So on examination, you find the baby to be irritable, peripheries are warm, weight is around 2.8 kg, which is loss of 400 grams from birth weight, which comes to around 12.5% of the weight, birth weight. And baby... It is more likely to be dehydration and it is less likely to be sepsis because there is... investigate the baby and whether recommend admission for this, hospitalization for this baby or not. So just few clinical parameters which would help you to differentiate between dehydration and sepsis are: dehydration, more commonly you will have fever. Sepsis, there may be fever, there may not be fever. So presence of fever does not always indicate sepsis, and absence of fever also does not rule out sepsis. Please understand. So weight loss is more likely in fever due to dehydration, but on the other hand, in sepsis, we may be trivial or there may be weight loss also. In dehydration fever, usually the peripheries are warm, even though the baby is looking dehydrated, peripheries are warm and pulses are well felt. While in sepsis, the peripheries may be cold, pulses may be weak. The activity of the baby in a dehydrated baby tends to be more often irritable than being lethargic, but a baby with sepsis will be lethargic. But nonetheless, if there is meningitis, then baby can be irritable too in sepsis, right? So when you measure serum sodium, which will help you to differentiate between dehydration and sepsis, serum sodium is either high normal or more than 145, hypernatremia in baby with dehydration. And sepsis, it can be normal. So of course, sometimes with associated other problems, it too can be abnormal, right? So these are all some clinical pointers which would help you to differentiate between dehydration and sepsis. But a common investigation which you would want to do in this baby include complete blood count, C-reactive protein, total serum bilirubin, and if not full electrolytes, serum sodium, which will help you to differentiate between these two conditions. So in our example, the total leukocyte count was 8,000 millimeter cube per cubic millimeter. ANC was 2,500, platelet count 2.5 lakh per cubic millimeter. So if you look at this CBC, all are looking normal. So what is abnormal is a total leukocyte count of less than 5,000 is considered suggestive of sepsis. High counts are not indicative of sepsis in a newborn. Absolute neutrophil count, which is less than 1,800, is again suggestive of sepsis, but you should not go by one single parameter. Platelet count, yes, if thrombocytopenia is present, it may be suggestive, but still, again, it is not considered as a sole marker of sepsis. CRP is a very good sensitive parameter, but it has got more of negative predictive value. That is, when CRP is negative, then you are reassured that it is not sepsis, rather than CRP being positive, which can be sepsis or not sepsis. So negative CRP is more helpful in ruling out sepsis than ruling in sepsis. Positive CRP ruling in sepsis. So total serum bilirubin in this baby, 13 acceptable. Serum sodium is high normal, 145 milliequivalents per liter. So the more likely diagnosis in this baby is going to be dehydration fever. So why this happens? So all of us know that neonates lose weight. So how much weight loss is? So why does it happen? It is because of contraction of the extracellular fluid volume. So all of us adults, as adult, we have more body water content is around 60%. But in newborns, it will be high. So in term babies, it will be around 70%. Preterm babies, it can be very high, up to 80 to 90%. Okay, in extreme preterms, it can be 90%. So this extracellular fluid volume has to be lost, and this happens after birth. Once the umbilical cord is clamped and systemic vascular resistance increases, when the systemic vascular resistance increases, systemic blood pressure increases, it distends the atria. Atrial baroreceptors are stimulated, and then a diuretic response happens because of that baby loses weight. So how much weight loss is normal? In a term baby or a late preterm baby, up to 10% is considered as normal. Anything more than 10% is pathological, and you should identify the cause and treat it. So it could be because of high ambient temperature when there is increased insensible water loss, especially in summer. We tend to see a lot of babies here in Chennai and also in other parts of the country where because of high ambient temperature, baby tend to sweat. And if baby is late preterm or moderate preterm, parents tend to cover the baby too much, thinking that baby may become hypothermic. It can be counterproductive, and baby may have more of sweating and insensible water loss, and they present with extremely high temperature, dehydration, and hypernatremia. There can be feeding issues, which can be due to improper positioning, attachment, mother not confident about feeding. So these breastfeeding issues are definitely, they add on to the high ambient temperature, the issues related to high ambient temperature in during summer. Somebody is marking on the slide. So to address the feeding issues, all of us are aware that proper positioning and proper attachment of the baby is important. So we need to ensure that mother knows how to position the baby and how to ensure proper attachment of the baby. And we need to see to that the prolactin milk secretion is adequately supported by early initiation of breastfeeding. Good attachment sucking is taught to the mother, and frequent night feeding should be advised. And those hindering factors should be identified and eliminated. Similarly, oxytocin ejection reflex, the enhancing factors mother should be taught of, and the hindering factors, anything if present in the mother, should be allayed. Right? So if the weight loss is more than 15%, if serum sodium is more than 145 milliequivalents per liter, and if you strongly think that there could be risk of concurrent sepsis in the baby, this baby would require admission and evaluation, right? Then we will go to the next scenario. Late preterm born at 36 weeks of gestation with a birth weight of 2.5 kilos presents on day 5 with jaundice. Mother's blood group is O positive and baby is B positive. So on examination, baby is found to be ectric up to thigh or legs, feeding well according to mother. Baby is not pale, baby is active. And if you look at the weight loss, that is also acceptable. It is around 8%, which is well within the normal range of 10%, which we describe now. So you are concerned about the jaundice in the baby, and you are evaluating the baby. So you are subjecting for total serum bilirubin, complete blood count, CRP, DCT, peripheral smear, and reti count, because there is OB setting is there. So if the let us look at the results. Total serum bilirubin is 14 milligram percent in a day 5 baby who is born at born at 36 weeks. DCT is negative, complete blood count is normal, and CRP is normal. So the question arises whether this bilirubin needs any treatment or not, whether to start phototherapy or wait. So how will we decide? So we need to look at, there are nomograms, NICE guidelines, which is based from UK, or AAP, American Academy of Pediatrics chart, or otherwise called as Bhutanese chart for phototherapy. So this gives you three different curves, which are for different risk groups. So the highermost line, which is the dotted line, is indicates infants at lower risk of jaundice. That is, those who are born at more than or equal to 38 weeks and do not have any risk factors. Middle line indicates babies born at 38 weeks and above with the presence of risk factors, are those born between 35 to 37 weeks and well baby. So infants at higher risk, that is lowermost line, include 35 to 37 weeks plus risk factors. So where would our baby fall? Our baby is born at 35 to 37 weeks and otherwise baby is a well baby. So this baby will fall in the middle line. So you may ask, this baby has a risk factor. So what are the risk factors? Risk factors which have to be considered in babies include blood group incompatibility. It can be RH or ABO. It can be asphyxia, sepsis, acidosis, temperature instability, hypoalbuminemia. These are all considered as a G6PD deficiency. These are all considered as risk factors. So you may ask here, baby is B positive and mother is O positive. Is it not considered as ABO incompatibility? Only if evidence of hemolysis is there in the presence or absence of positive DCT, then we take it as presence of ABO incompatibility. Otherwise, just mere presence of O and A group does not say that it is ABO incompatibility. So this baby falls in the middle group, middle line. So at 5 days of life, the cutoff for phototherapy here would be somewhere around 22. So this baby can be safely sent home with a bilirubin of 14 and followed up after a couple of days to see whether things are improving, right? So similarly, there are different charts are available for preterm babies. Especially NICE guidelines gives separate charts for preterm babies according to gestation. AAP gives something called as a table, which we call as NICELS chart. Based on different gestation group ranges, the range of bilirubin which would need phototherapy is provided. For want of time, I have not put up those slides here. So then a note on prolonged jaundice, when you should be concerned. So you may see some babies after 2 weeks or 3 weeks presenting still with some amount of jaundice. So prolonged jaundice, when it persists beyond 2 weeks in a term baby or beyond 3 weeks in a preterm baby. So our aim here is to rule out direct hyperbilirubinemia, because if there is direct hyperbilirubinemia, the whole sort of investigation is going to be different. So if direct bilirubin, when you will call it as direct hyperbilirubinemia, when is it significant? So according to NASGAN guidelines, direct bilirubin of more than 1 mg% is significant if total bilirubin is less than 5. Or if total serum bilirubin is more than 5, then anything about 20% of the total, that is if direct is more than 20% of the total, then it is taken as significant. So if it is predominantly conjugated bilirubinemia, the causes could be different. Hepatitis or any biliary tract obstruction, it could be metabolic problems, which we need to evaluate. It is an unconjugated bilirubinemia, so you need to rule out common treatable causes. So it could be Brassenell jaundice, it could be persisting hemolysis, it could be hypothyroidism, or it could be new or persisting sepsis, especially UTI, you have to rule out. These are all things which OPD practice. So if there is prolonged jaundice, please do a TA examination, do a urine culture, and look for blood group, DCT, reti count if possible. And if all these things are negative, consider breast milk jaundice as a possibility, especially if the baby is thriving well, gaining weight adequately, and bilirubins are not very high. So even in breast milk jaundice, if the bilirubins are well below the phototherapy ranges, you don't have to interrupt breastfeeding as earlier recommended. You can keep continuing breastfeeding and you can just educate the parents that this jaundice is innocuous and you don't have to worry about this jaundice. Anyway, it is going to take time and subside, right? Fine. Next case scenario, term neonate born at 39 weeks of gestation, presents on day 7 with redness around umbilicus. So it is one thing which you would commonly encounter in newborn office practice, umbilical discharge. So how we should approach? Before that, we need to know how we should care for the cord. So because some of us would be attending deliveries and we would be taking care of the postnatal newborns also, right? So cord care in settings with high NMR, okay, based on a systematic review. So it has been found that applying some medication, especially chlorhexidine application, 4% to the umbilical cord is helpful in areas where there is high NMR. Okay, our in India is a diverse country, and you know, you can see a lot of variations in NMR. When you look at NMR in Tamil Nadu, it is only 10 per thousand live births. In some states like you know, Maharashtra, Indian NMR is around 24 per thousand live births, but Madhya Pradesh, UP, Bihar have higher than 30. Okay, so in settings with high NMR, then this intervention is found to be useful. It reduces all-cause mortality by 20% and reduces the risk of encephalitis by 50%. So chlorhexidine can be applied. Whether it applies to our setting, that is Tamil Nadu, no. So here you have to recommend dry cord care. Why dry cord care? Because applying something to the cord itself can delay cord care. So there is a recent study from Nepal where they identified, compared dry cord care with application of chlorhexidine and application of soap and water to the cord. So they found out that the time to cord separation was shortest in the dry cord care group, and it was slightly longer in soap and water group, and it was much more longer in chlorhexidine group. So dry cord care definitely helps in early separation of cord and prevents infection. So unless otherwise our baseline NMR is high, we don't recommend application of anything to the cord. Why we should not apply? What is harm? Yes, there is harm.
Dr. Chandra, two more minutes, please. We are running short of time.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Okay.
So there is harm in applying things to the umbilical cord. So we need to take care of it. So this encephalitis is due to gram-positive or gram-negative organisms. Gram-positive organism, mostly the practitioners recommend some tea-backed ointment or something to bimuprosin to cover gram-positive organisms. So gram-negative may in fact be predominant in umbilical sepsis. So it presents with local as well as systemic signs. But if possible, do an umbilical swab for culture sensitivity. The treatment is always intravenous antibiotics with cloxacillin gentamicin. If you think MRSA is prevalent, you can use vancomycin. If gram-negative is more common in your setting, then you may have to use a gram-negative coverage like piperacillin. So case scenario 4, term newborn 38 weeks. I think for want of time, I will skip this. I'll come to case scenario 5. So a mother comes to OPD and she asks for, baby is on exclusive breastfeeding, and she asks for supplements to be given to the baby. So we do not have to give too many supplements to the baby. So initially vitamin D is essential. It has to be given to all babies, 400 international units per day till 1 year of age. And then iron recommendation also is, iron supplementation is also recommended for all babies from fourth month completion, that is fifth month onwards, at 1 mg/kg per day till 1 year. Other than these two, no other supplementations are required for a baby who is on exclusive breastfeeding. So the final scenario is, now we come across with so many newborns who have been advised universal newborn screening, and the report shows TSH of 20, how to proceed. So there is in the Indian Society of Pediatric and Adolescent Endocrinology guidelines, which says that based on heel prick or cord blood TSH on first screen, if TSH is more than 20 or TSH less than 20 or TSH less than 34 in the sample, if taken between 24 to 48 hours, this is considered as normal. TSH of less than 20 or less than 34 in 24 to 48 hours is normal. If TSH is more than 20, what you have to do? If it is more than 80, you have to start treatment immediately. If TSH more than 40, you have to confirm with a venous sample. If TSH between 20 to 40, you have to repeat a sample. Okay, so this is how you proceed. So this is the algorithm. So if you find a normal T4 and a high TSH, you will repeat TSH after 2 weeks. If TSH comes down to below 10, it is normal. If TSH remains more than 10, then TSH persistently more than 10 after the age of 3 weeks with normal T4 report, we have to start treatment and reassess at 3 years of age. So this is important. Any TSH which is persistently more than 10 after 3 weeks should be treated. If there is low T4, that is low T4 less than 1.1 or FT4 or low T4 less than 8, irrespective of TSH, or low FT4 less than 1.17 or T4 less than 10, in the presence of TSH more than 20, you have to start treatment. If it is normal, then you don't have to do anything. So this is how you approach an abnormal TSH in the screening in the newborn follow-up in office practice. So let us not discuss too much about a moderate preterm, because they are in bit of a high-risk group. They need growth monitoring, feeding, fortification, supplementation, temperature maintenance, advice on KMC and immunization, and frequent follow-up. So to summarize, follow-up visit should be timed based on risks, based on gestation, feeding problem, and the risk for jaundice. You screen for growth, jaundice, and superficial infection. And if newborn screening, if universally done, you need to look at the values. And if there are abnormal values, you need to address specifically to those concerns. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Chandra, for the presentation. This is a too short a period for a very big topic as that. My one question is that in the current scenario of COVID, when do you ask them to come for follow-up?
So in current scenario, thanks ma'am, current scenario of COVID, if the baby is well and mother has tested positive and baby also has tested positive at 48 hours and a baby is well, we discharge them as early as possible and we do not call them for follow-up until after 10 days. Because after 10 days, we expect the baby to become negative, but retesting is also not is not advised. So we usually call them for follow-up after 10 days.
Then for the late preterms,
yes, ma'am.
How much percentage, or I mean, amongst them, how many could be neurologically those who have been well without showing much of the signs of change in the tone or whatever it is? How many of them could turn to be neurologically affected babies?
So this late preterm group as such is a high-risk group. Why? Because the incidence of certain morbidities are much higher in them. Okay, respiratory morbidities especially, transient tachypnea of newborn or mild RDS can be high, requiring some sort of respiratory intervention. Admission in NICU is very high. They have a lot of feeding problems. They have high risk of jaundice. They have high risk of hypoglycemia and hypothermia. So because of these all common five complications, of course, these babies tend to be hospitalized. Their hospital stay is longer and they may need a frequent follow-up also. If there are any one complication which has occurred, then these babies tend to do relatively less well than their term counterparts. So there are interesting studies which have seen that even every 1 week delay increases the IQ by certain points. Okay, so that's why the indication for elective cesarean is now 39 weeks. It is not, even though we consider 37 weeks as term, so we do not recommend any delivery, elective delivery before 39 weeks of gestation.